It's Monday on Rachon, and that means that one and only Joe Lindsley is again with us. Great to see you again. Joe, so how was
another attack?
I don't know what was the last time we talked about Russia preparing their missile attack against Ukraine, and we got the attack. The attack was on. All of those, at least that's what comes out from the Reuters reports, all of those missile ballistic missiles were shot down by the Ukrainian defense. The same goes with the Shahid drones. So what's up?
Well, Mihail, hello from Lviv, where it's calm, cold, and snowy. We have electricity and power and heat. What happened through the night, one was quite an unusual thing. At 4:15 in the morning, a Russian missile hit Kyiv before the air raid alarm could sound. That's very unusual. That's happened once in the past several months. But Kyiv is generally far enough into Ukraine that there usually is warning. So that's of some concern. But you know, I think as we look at the headlines of this, you know, what happened.
Sorry, Joe.
This
so let's just emphasize this. So we do not have like a full protection, and that means that the missile attack at least partly was successful.
Actually, it seems that air defense successfully kept the missiles outside of the city of Kyiv. There was some debris that fell over the city of Kyiv, but all of the reports indicate that all of those missiles coming toward Kyiv were intercepted. And so what the Russians did hit, they destroyed a cottage in a village outside of Kyiv, and 120 people were without power for a few hours. And this has to be put in perspective, because I see the narrative running away like crazy, even in media that seems to be sympathetic to Ukraine. Oh, Kyiv is hit again. Oh, here come the infrastructure attacks that we've been talking about since August. And it's very important to note that, you know, a year ago, those were serious infrastructure attacks. We had no power, no electricity most of the day, no hot water, 100 missiles more or less every week throughout Ukraine. What we see this year, you know, it's been months without a major missile attack. This was the biggest one in some time in Kyiv, but none of the missiles really made it to the city. The air defense worked, and the Russians destroyed a cottage in the village, and 120 people were out of power for a few hours. Those eight missiles cost something like $32 million to the Russians to put 120 people out of power for a few hours, people who probably already had generators because everyone was ready for a winter like last year. And so as we see right now with, for example, President Zelenskyy in Washington and all the debates on Ukraine funding, I see this line, which I really don't like to see in news reports and some op-eds as well. Oh, Kyiv is being hit again. The infrastructure attacks are back. That's just not true. Ukraine is so much more well-protected and well-off.
So as I understand it, the headline should go like another failed Russian attack against Kyiv, yeah, after months of preparations.
Yeah, well, as you said in the intro, you know, after 4 months of preparing, this is what they have. And you know, this doesn't mean that we should be complacent, that at some point, you know, the longer we wait, some point Russia is going to have a new stockpile and they're going to have a massive attack. That's going to happen. But right now we still have this window. And by the way, those drones that they sent, the 18 Iranian-produced Shahid drones that came, they were launched from Crimea. And if Ukrainians had the ability and the permission and the blessing, especially of the United States, to hit Russian bases in Russia, in occupied Crimea, we could put a stop to this. And we've had a window now of months. And, you know, as we look at with President Zelenskyy in Washington, and the White House has been saying, if Congress doesn't approve this spending package, by the end of the year, it's going to be very dire. Money is going to run out for Ukraine. But there's something fishy there. For example, in that spending package, Mihail, is $2.3 billion for refugees. Ukrainians don't need that. The refugees that are in Poland or Germany, they're working, they're making money, they send money back home to Ukraine. I don't know where that money is supposed to go, but what needs to be in that package is long-range weapons.
With all your experience, you've spent years, you know Washington very well, you know the media landscape of the United States, you know very well the political reality of both parties in the U.S. I wonder what you make of it, because it looks like we are having a debate in the Congress, in the Senate regarding whether to send money or not to send money. And on the other hand, we do have another visit. Zelenskyy is coming to the White House, but I'm not convinced if the weapons, if the attackams or other missiles or other tools that Ukraine can use to regain Crimea, to hit Russia far behind the front line, is really the subject and the substance of those discussions. Because it looks like we are in the process, as I mentioned in the intro, of cooking as some kind of a political deal that is being discussed behind the curtains. And in a way, this whole debate about whether to send or not to send money to Ukraine is convenient, actually, for both sides ahead of the US presidential election.
Yeah, exactly. It's convenient for both sides. And, you know, the White House can say, oh, we're doing everything we can, without having to make the courageous decision to say, we believe that Moscow can be defeated. And just like the Brits, who gave Ukraine the Storm Shadow missiles that they used to hit the Russian Black Sea Fleet, if the United States and the White House had the courage to say, we actually believe in victory, we need to make this happen now. We have a window of opportunity because Russia has been weakened, because its navy has been weakened. Here's the moment to strike. And instead, we have this gamesmanship. And, you know, that report from the White House Office of Management and Budget, you know, the dire report that was quoted in the media saying that the money's going to run out. If you look at it closely, it looks like it was written by some kind of junior level grant writer seeking money for a parks and recs department. It was not precisely about military victory for Ukraine. And again, if you look at a lot of the spending, it's for things that have nothing to do with weapons. And so you can understand why, you know, Republicans, some of them would be skeptical. And that's why I encourage people really to look at that report that we discussed last week, led by Representative Michael McCaul, the chairman of the House Foreign Affairs Committee from Texas. He and several other Republicans are criticizing the Republicans who don't support Ukraine and the White House for pretending to support victory when they're not actually giving Ukraine the tools to do it.
And if you look, our viewers can find our discussion about this document last week. It's very interesting and eye-opening in a way regarding the way that the mainstream Republicans are thinking about the Ukraine war. So what do you make of another piece of very interesting puzzle jigsaw that we see here? A brief meeting between Zelensky and Orban in Argentina with the info about the meeting and conversation of the foreign ministers of two European states that are having absolutely contradictory interests in this part of the world, which is pretty obvious for everyone who is following the developments of the Russian-Ukrainian war.
Well, when I looked, you know, and it was actually, and this is a very important point to point out, that the new president of Argentina, Milei, who's a hero to many Americans who don't support Ukraine, he clearly stands with Ukraine. You can look at the way he embraced President Zelensky. He invited Zelensky to the inauguration. It's very rare for Zelensky in wartime to attend events like that. Usually it's just a very quick, focused meeting. And whoever designed the seating put Zelensky next to Viktor Orban. And when I saw that Zelensky confronted Orban, and when I saw that image, I thought, you know, here we have the actual freedom fighters versus the freedom talkers. And Orban will be in Washington about the same time as Zelensky. I think he's there right now, meeting with the Heritage Foundation, a place where I started my career. I had an internship there, and they raised tons of money from freedom-loving Americans saying, well, we believe in family values and freedom and dignity and all these things. And they are inviting Orban. They're their opponents of Ukraine, the Heritage Foundation in D.C., and Orban will be speaking there. And, you know, one of their topics is the culture wars, you know, because it's easy to score political points to say, oh, we're fighting, you know, Orban is somehow portrayed as a freedom fighter when all he does is talk and say, oh, I'm defending, you know, the West against cultural, you know, for defending the cultural values of the West. The people actually defending that are the Ukrainian soldiers in the front lines. It's the civilians that refuse to leave their cities, the people that hold on to their traditions, their family, their religion. By the way, we just found out over the weekend that in Russian-occupied parts of Ukraine, the Knights of Columbus is banned by the Russian authorities. The Ukrainian Greek Catholic Church is banned. So this is really the fight of Western civilization. And it's difficult. And so what we see is the well-funded freedom talkers like Orban, like Tucker Carlson, like the Heritage Foundation simply talk about it. And that's why it's so extraordinary to see Milei, who he sees the fight of Israel against Hamas, the fight of the Chinese people for freedom, and the fight of Ukrainians as the same struggle. And so maybe we can start to see a breakthrough here beyond these two partisan sides, that neither of which is very honest about their intentions.
Yeah, this is a very interesting point, actually. I've read a couple of tweets, very interesting tweets, regarding the Heritage Foundation, and I wonder if you could try to explain, because I think I've read a tweet of one of our guests who said that we, the Reagan Republicans, remember who is talking to Heritage Foundation right now, and he was tweeting that because of the roots of the Heritage Foundation. What is the reason for which this entity, a profound and important institution in U.S., in Republican U.S. Landscape, is being criticized by people who feel themselves as a Reagan Republicans? What does it mean?
Well, I think this has to be a question, just as the Democrats need to ask themselves, we can wave the banner of Ukraine and say we support Ukraine, but do we actually support Ukraine if we don't give long-range weapons? They have to ask that existential question. And Republicans have to ask the existential question. You know, for decades, going back to the days of Reagan, we've said our identity is for freedom versus tyranny. And you know, I mean, I was schooled by all these organizations, the Intercollegiate Studies Institute, the Heritage Foundation, many of the people involved in this Project 2025, which is working on, they want a new Republican administration. They're the ones that have invited Viktor Orban. And so we really have to step back and say, look at who Orban is. Look at his rhetoric. Look at how, his neighboring nation is in the actual fight for freedom of our times, the greatest fight for freedom of our times. And I think this is part of the reason, Michal, why Americans don't, I've really been trying to figure out, why don't so many of these so-called freedom-loving Americans support Ukraine? And when I look at people like Orban and even Milei, I think we're so used to in the eastern parts of the world, people have tyrants. You know, it's very vertical systems in China and in Russia. But in the West, we sort of make our own, we have to have our sort of, we make our democratic leaders into kind of monarchs, and we have this cults of personality. And, Orban says all the right things, and so people rally around him. And Zelensky's not like that. Ukraine doesn't have a person like that because Ukrainians are so fiercely democratic and horizontal that they don't worship their politicians the way we do in the West. And so that's why it's hard for people in the West to, unless they're here or they pay attention, to really understand how deeply ingrained the sense of freedom is in Ukraine. We're not reliant upon these parties and these politicians far away from us. And so it's easy. I can see why it's easy for that story to get missed. But this is where there has to be, there's a smattering of Republicans led by Michael McCaul, Mike Rogers, Mike Turner, who say, this is the battle for freedom of our times. We can win it efficiently without having to risk American lives if we move swiftly.
Maybe I will surprise you in a way, but as I just listened to the Bill O'Reilly's podcast last week, Bill O'Reilly is for many years off Fox News. He's running his website, BillO'Reilly.com. He was our guest 2 years ago after he published his book, Killing Reagan, on Polish market. And when he was answering questions of his subscribers on his YouTube channel, he was asked by one of the Republicans subscribers of his system why U.S. should send money to Ukraine. And the man who was replaced on his position in Fox News by Tucker Carlson, which is Bill O'Reilly, said that do not support Ukraine will be much more expensive for United States. If United States allows Russia to go out successful from a grab land, from atrocities, from killing of people at their backyard in sovereign country Ukraine, the US will have to ultimately pay much higher bill. And it's remarkable that those are the words of a man who was replaced by Tucker Carlson before Carlson was ousted from Fox News not so long time ago. Your comment?
Yeah, and I used to know all these characters, of course, in my time at Fox News. But I think they're we're going with the baseball games with them. And so I know a bit about their personalities and who's more sincere. But if you look at, for one, there's a clear, like what Bill O'Reilly was saying, the clear calculus of, send weapons to Ukraine. It's not really money. It's mainly weapons, old weapons being sent, which you have to keep emphasizing. Weapons that we were not using anyway, by the way, which help us develop better weapons because we can test them in this battlefield experience. And then it's great marketing because for the 20 HIMARS that U.S. gave to Ukraine, Poland is buying $10 billion worth of HIMARS. So it's a benefit financially for the U.S. But then I think for the question for American conservatives and libertarians is, you know, or people who say they love freedom, is the cultural question. You know, I see so many Americans reacted to what's happening in Ireland. You know, some of the protests there and Irish citizens killed by immigrants and people saying, oh, Irish culture, we got to defend it. It's dying. And they do this all around Europe. But, you know, Ukrainian culture is a culture of family values, of freedom. You know, the religion is strong. It's a tolerant society, but people cling to their tradition. They cultivate their traditions. And it's exactly the sort of society that Americans would love. It's not corporate controlled. People know how to grow their own food. All the things that Americans are sort of waking up to now exist right here, right now. And it's actually under dire threat from missiles and bullets. And so, once this is gone, then the paradise that these people are looking for will be removed. And in some sense, I think that in America, we just like to be angry and respond to things. And the Russians know this, by the way. Sergei Lavrov, speaking at the Doha Forum, interviewed by Al Jazeera, who said when he was asked to justify the reasons for making the war against Ukraine, he just kept saying cancel culture. He said the war against Ukraine is a war against cancel culture. And
it's an all Russian disinfo campaign. They are reading between the lines of our internal Western debates and are posing as one or the other side. If it is going to be good for Russia's imperial policy, they are going to be rainbowed from top to the bottom. That just doesn't matter. Since this is in their interest right now, they are pretending to be conservatives while keeping Russia as a state with the highest abortions number in the world. So it's just disinfo, the great
disinfo.
Go on.
Well, yeah, and Russia is not a free society whatsoever. And you know, and here we have Ukraine is incredibly vertical society. Going back to the days of the Cossacks and the wild fields, they had a constitution with separation of powers in 1711. And all this is lost because of Russian imperialism, the way they've worked for centuries to crush Ukrainians.
Russia does, whenever any of the neighboring countries creates the constitution, the liberal constitution, like the Polish constitution of the 3rd May, or any other state is waking up to freedom, like Chechens in the beginning of 1990s, like Georgians in the beginning of the 20th century, and then again in the beginning of the 21st century, they always react in the same manner. Send some tanks. Kill some people. This is not a freedom-loving society. Vladimir Putin is not a conservative. He is just a maniac murderer that is killing people in hundreds of thousands, because over the span of his 20 years in office, this number is that high. In Chechnya only, it was 300,000 people with 40,000 children killed over there. Joe, thanks again. See you soon.
Yeah, and by the way, we just bought 3 thermal imagers, thanks to the viewers of TVP. So as long as the show continues, we are able to help the guys to the front while we wait for long-range missiles to put an end to this.
So look for Joe Lindsley online. You can find Joe Lindsley's Substack. We are on Substack as well. And if you do want to, you can donate and you can support the freedom-fighting people who are really fighting the orcs stealing their land, as in the Lord of the Rings, because that's really very good example of what is going on in Ukraine. Joe, thanks a lot.
UkrainianFreedomNews.com. Dziękuję. Thank you, Michał.